two vaccines for the same virus, SARS-CoV-2, better known as COVID-19. They use different technologies, but for a common cause, to help life return to normal. Now a study has been launched to see if they can be mixed and matched. The trial will use the Oxford AstraZeneca and the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccines. First, they'll look at the difference when you use two doses of the same vaccine, 4 weeks and then 12 weeks apart. Then they will see what happens when you combine the two vaccines, swapping the first and second dose around and seeing which time lag is more effective, 4 or 12 weeks.
Well, it would mean that we could be a lot more flexible in the way that we offer vaccination to people. So, for example, if somebody went along to have their first vaccine and they only had the Oxford vaccine and they had to have that, but then they went back to have their booster and they didn't have the Oxford vaccine available for logistical reasons, then they could have a different vaccine for their second dose.
But this is not just about the UK's rollout. There are implications too for developing countries and their critical need for access to vaccines.
Actually, if we can show that it's safe and effective to use different schedules, then that could mean we'd be able to vaccinate more people around the world more quickly.
This is the first study looking at using the RNA vaccine, which is the Pfizer-BioNTech, and a viral vector vaccine, which is the Oxford-AstraZeneca one, all in the same schedule. And it has worked in animal studies. But now they need to see it in people aged 50 and over, and they expect early results in June. Putting out a fire of different sorts, the rescue service helping vaccinate in Basingstoke today.
You're here for the AstraZeneca vaccine today.
I am.
Are you happy about that?
I'm very happy about it.
Brilliant.
Okay. Research earlier this week seemed to show that the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine could cut transmission of the virus by two-thirds. And now public health experts say it should be rolled out faster in hotspots.
But with this extra effect, effectively vaccination becomes also a tool of prevention and suppression of the vaccine, control of transmission. So what we're going to need to do is to use the vaccine to give an equal chance of every local authority area or every community to exit the pandemic at the same rate. Now, if we have very different rates of coronavirus transmission in different local authorities, to get them all exiting at the same point, what we need to do is to accelerate the vaccination process in areas of high transmission.
COVID-19 case rates are continuing to fall across the UK with signs that we are now past the peak of this current wave. But it is a slow downward trend, and scientists and the government are still warning that infection rates are high.
And Victoria joins us from the newsroom. Now, Victoria, what do we know about the uptake of the vaccine so far?
Yes, John, we were told by the vaccines minister Nadeem Zahawi today that there has been a fantastically high uptake of the vaccines in the UK. 85% of people who have been offered the jab have accepted it. But there is that 15% who for some reason are not being vaccinated or not wanting to be vaccinated. And data is showing that this 15% is heavily skewed towards people who are Black, Asian or from a minority ethnic community. In fact, recent research from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine found that white people were twice as likely to have been vaccinated than Black people. It has become clear, though, that the refusal rates are not being tracked, so we don't know precisely who or why. And this is important. Now, we have heard a lot on this programme about vaccine hesitancy, but there is a feeling that without this data, it is much more difficult to tackle it. NHS England has said that it will start recording ethnicity when people go for the vaccines, regardless of whether it's at a vaccine hub or at the GP surgery. But they haven't given a time frame for that.